After 10 years after takeoff, we see that in the sunk cost after 1990, GDP per capita in these countries that managed to take off is about 60% higher than at the beginning of the takeoff. While those countries that didn't manage to take off increased their GDP per capita only by about 15%. Before 1990, the increase for those that managed to take off was about 50%, and those that didn't, only about 5%. So it was almost staggering, looking at the median score. Okay? So having a growth take off really pays off, according to this figure. It really increases your income per capita well beyond the cases where income per capita doesn't increase. Now, why did I say that these are not, the comparison is not as clear as I mentioned before, is because what we're doing here is we separate, we don't look at countries per se, but we look at pairs of country years. Okay? So let me give you an example. Cambodia started a growth takeoff in 1996, and it's still ongoing. So from 1996 to 2011, Cambodia is in a growth takeoff, and it's going to appear in the blue area over there, in the shaded area. Now, Cambodia in 1995 was not in a growth takeoff. What did we do with that? So Cambodia in 1995 is a different country year. That we put it in here. So this yellow area not only has the countries that never managed to take off, but also has the countries that took off, but in the period prior to the takeoff. What does it imply? So if I look at Cambodia in 1985, it's going to appear as it was not in takeoff in year one, but actually 96, 97, 98 are going to be part of this sample over here. So the methodology that we have used, if anything, is actually biasing this group to be better than what would be otherwise. Right? So the discrepancy between the two bars could be even higher if in here we have taken just those countries that never took off. Then the performance of this would be even poorer than what appears. Okay? Alright. Now, just to conclude with this part, so this graph gives you a bit more of a longer perspective with respect to that group that took off before 1990. And if you take a look to this area that we have in here, I mean, it appears small, but this is basically the same graph that we had before in the previous slide for the period 1950 to 1990. What we have done here, we added 20 more years because we wanted to see what happened to those groups over time. And what we see is that the median economy keep increasing GDP per capita. Actually, GDP per capita reaches doubles in about 20 years, or a bit more than 20 years. So it keeps paying off. But what we saw in the past is also that some of the countries that managed to take off, to grow fast, actually reversed afterwards. You see that that area goes down in here? It means that some of the countries that managed to grow fast for about 20 years reversed part of the gains afterwards. Okay? So basically, we're going to be looking at two things in here. We already saw that being in a growth takeoff is positive. So we want to see what do we think that are the variables that can help a country to enter a growth takeoff. And second, we're going to also look at what happened to these countries over here. Why did they get derailed? Why did they lose some of the gains that they made? Do we see signs of this today? Okay? And for that, what we do, basically in our analysis, we do three exercises. First, we look at the candidate set of variables that we think may help explaining why some countries take off and others don't. And we do each variable at a time. We call it a bivariate association. The second exercise is that when we look at all these variables and we put them together in something that we call a logic analysis. And the last exercise that we do is we look at a specific case study, specific experiences of countries to gather a bit more of the detail of what really happened in this economy at that particular time. Okay? So I'm gonna go into this now, case by case. And in each case, we're gonna be comparing the fast growers with respect to those countries that didn't manage to take off. And we're also gonna be comparing the fast grower post-1990 with the fast grower prior to 1990. So what do we find? So the way we present the result is a bit different from the other one. So here we show basically three snapshots. We're gonna look at the average of the variables in the 5 years prior to takeoff, then the average of the variable in the first 5 years of the takeoff, and the average of the variable in the year 6 to 10, in the following 5 years from the takeoff. The blue bar in here corresponds to those low-income countries that managed to take off, that had a strong growth, while the red bar corresponds to those countries that didn't manage to take off, so therefore they didn't have a strong growth. The stars on the horizontal axis correspond to when these two bars, the distribution of these two bars is statistically significant from each other. And this star over here means that this bar is statistically significantly different from this bar, from the blue bar over here, okay? Don't worry about that now, I mean, but I'm gonna tell you what is our main finding. So when we compare, remember here we have the episode before 1990 and the episode after 1990. When we compare these two groups, we find that there are similarities and there are differences between the fast grower post-1990 and the fast grower prior 1990. What are the major similarities that we find? The first similarity that we find is that investment has played a role to explain why this country has faster growth. Generally, those countries that manage to take off, they have higher and increasing ratio of investment to GDP. Okay? The more you invest, the more you grow. And you see that the difference between the blue bar and the red bar is significantly different from zero, according to this star. And the same for the previous generation. So that's something common. Before 1990 and after 1990, having high investment seems to matter to have a strong growth. The second element, which I don't have here in the presentation, because I could not put all the graph there, but you can find it in the chapter, is that those countries that managed to take off, those countries that were growing fast, not only they had higher investment, but they also had higher national savings. So they were financing the investment with national savings. In fact, when you look at the current account, I don't know how much background in macroeconomics you have, but the current account, one way that we look at this is just the difference between national savings and investment. So it's the part that you cannot, the part of investment that you cannot finance with domestic savings. When you look at that, you find that the current account is very similar prior to 1990 and post-1990, and it's very similar across the countries that grew fast and those that didn't grow fast. In other words, it's just saying that those countries that grew fast is because they invested more and they financed that, at least partly, with national savings. Okay? Now, this is in the similarity part. The other similarity that we have, and I have it at the end of the presentation, and I can show it when we get there, but the other clear similarity that we see between the fast growers today with respect to the fast growers before 1990, is that those countries that managed to grow fast, they also had a very fast growth export. The export to GDP ratio was higher than those that didn't grow fast, and it was increasing faster, okay? So two elements. Those countries that grow faster invest more and export more. They're more export-oriented. Now, on the differences. What is the difference of today's fast grower with respect to previous fast growers? So one of the differences that we see is that today we see a much higher role of foreign direct investment for the fast growers. So this is investment that is made by foreign residents. And you see that these countries that were growing fast actually had much higher ratios of foreign direct investment than those that didn't grow fast, and also much higher than those that grew fast in the past. We see this as a positive sign. Why is that? There are different reasons why we would think that having foreign direct investment coming to the economy is a good thing. There are the issue of related to development. The first one is that foreign direct investment can bring new technologies that are used abroad. In general, foreign direct investment, if they are important projects, they help to improve the institutions in the country where they come. And lastly, is not debt. Okay? So the investors are sharing the risk of whatever happened in your economy with you. When you are indebted, when you take debt to finance your investment, and then you have a negative shock and the profitability of your business goes down, you still have to pay the debt, which is the safest stock that you have to pay, and maybe you're not going to be able to pay it. In here, they are taking the risk of that happening. Okay? So as a source of financing, is a better source of financing than debt. In fact, when we look at external debt, we see that there is also a difference between the pattern of external debt of today low-income countries with respect to the past. The fast growers of today, that I mean after 1990, in general, they've been reducing the stock of external debt during their growth takeoff. And they've been reducing it more than those that didn't manage to grow. In the past, what we saw is that these countries were increasingly financing their investment with more and more debt. The debt to GDP ratio was increasing. You see here? And in fact, many of these countries, about, I think it was about one third of them, ended up with a financial crisis after their growth takeoff. And the reason for that is that they have too high debt. Once they were hit by a negative shock, they couldn't pay and they had to go into default. One of our case studies actually points to that. So we think that one of the reasons why this external debt is falling is because we are financing now investment with different flows, not with debt creating flows, but with foreign direct investment. It's foreign direct investment that is increasing the investment in these fast growing economies. The other difference that we see with respect to the past, and this is also something that I mean, is very important now, is that those countries that managed to take off is actually those countries that managed to reduce imbalances in their economies. First, they reduce their external imbalances by reducing their exposure through external debt, but also domestic imbalances. They actually achieve macroeconomic stability, as we can see here, by the falling rate of inflation. So many of these countries, prior to the takeoff, they have high rate of inflation, but they made the effort to reduce inflation. And bringing macroeconomic stability seems to pay off, not only in terms of bringing more stability to the economy, but also in terms of promoting growth, okay? Which is not always an obvious thing, but we do see it in the data. Inflation in the past for the median economy in general was relatively low, so we didn't see the need for this stabilization. And if anything, it was marginally increasing, but it was never really high. But today, today's fast growers are those that they are doing the effort in terms of improving macroeconomic stability. Yes, one point to clarify here, and I'm not sure whether you are familiar with the term HIPIC, but one element that is behind this improvement in macroeconomic performance of the fast growing economy is the HIPIC initiative. The HIPIC initiative is an initiative for highly indebted poor countries that was adopted by the World Bank and the IMF since the mid-90s. The idea was, at that moment, these two institutions realized that there were a lot of poor countries, particularly in Africa, that were highly indebted. They had very large debts, and growth was very poor. I mean, they were not growing at all, and they didn't have the resources to finance, for example, investment in infrastructure. So they agreed on introducing this debt forgiveness, but it was not unconditional. To qualify for debt forgiveness, this country, they had to enter a HIPIC program with the World Bank and the IMF, in which one of the requirements was that they needed to reduce their macroeconomic imbalances. They needed to reduce inflation, they needed to reduce their budget deficit. In other words, these two institutions required these countries to show commitment that once debt was forgiven, they were not going to go out and acquire new debt. Okay? So things were going to be done better this time. So part of this improvement is due to this initiative here. But when we exclude those countries from the sample, we still see, for the others that did not benefit from that initiative, we still see debt going down and we still see inflation going back. So it's a more generalized episode. What else do we see? Another difference that we see of today's fast growers with respect to the past fast growers is on the diversification of exports. And here we have two measures of diversification. So exports of the fast growers today are more diversified with respect to who they trade with, their trading partners. Today's fast growers, they trade a lot more with emerging markets. And this emerging market group includes China, for example. So a lot of these low-income countries are actually trading more with emerging market economies today. They're also trading with advanced economies, but they have stronger linkages with the emerging markets. And that's significant across the board. So one of the reasons why they did well through the crisis probably is because they were trading with this group of countries that managed to keep growing fast during 2009, 2010, 2011, for example China, and that helped them to sustain growth during this period. So today fast growers, they are more diversified in terms of they trade with more people and they trade with those that they're growing fast. And they're also more diversified in terms of what they export. This is an export concentration index. It means the higher this bar, the less goods you export. Okay? If you just export one of them, then the bar is going to go to the top. The more different goods you export, then you're going to have a smaller bar. And what you see in here is that the fast growers, actually, they have more diversified exports. They have a broader base of exports. Although some of these diversification tend to be lost over time as they grow. And the reason for that, when we look at the data, is because some of these fast-growing countries, particularly in Africa, they have found natural resources in the way. And we have one example, Mozambique, for example, that they had about 10 years of fast growth, and then they found natural gas and coal. And the economy is moving now to natural resources, and they're becoming less diversified because of that. But it's not the general trend for other groups.